हेलो
हेलो सर,
हेलो। हाय, यू गाइस कैन हियर मी राइट? ओके, सो वी आर गोइंग टू कंटिन्यू विद द थियोरी। टुडे आई वांट टू कवर एटलीस्ट दीज थ्री थिंग्स। हियर फर्स्ट वील लुक एट द थियोरी, देन वील गो बैक टू द प्रॉब्लम। सो लास्ट वीक्स असाइनमेंट ऑल्सो आई वांट टू डिस्कस सम प्रॉब्लम्स फ्रॉम देयर। ओके, बट फर्स्ट वील ट्राई टू फिनिश द थियोरी पार्ट। So we'll start off with Fermat's little theorem. So what is this all about? So basically this is going to tell you that if you take a number and its powers, right, powers of a number. So let's take a number A. And start raising it to its powers, right? So we look at a square, a cube, a power 4, and so on, and look at it modulo p, where p is a prime number, So let's take some examples. So for example, p is, let's say 5, right? And we are going to look at any random number A. The only condition on A being that GCD of A and P is not greater than 1, basically, is equal to 1, right? GCD of A and P is equal to 1. So basically, they don't divide each other, right? If that doesn't divide each other, then what we get is, pick any number, pick say, let's say 3. So look at 3. 3 square is 9. 9 mod p, mod 5. 9 mod 5 is 4. 3 cube is 27. 27 mod p is what? 2. 3 power 4 is 81. And 81 mod p, mod 5 is 1, right? And 3 power 5 and so on. 3 power 5, let's do. So that is 243. So that will be 3 again. And 6 will be 729. That will be 4 again. So now you can see a repetition, right? Correct. So as you go to higher powers, now you'll get 2 and 1, right? Correct, no? Are you understanding this pattern? I'm taking 3 powers, 3 power 1, 3 power 2, 3 power 3, 3 power 4, and so on. All of these numbers, I'm taking it modulo 5, where p is a prime number. So what you will notice is that 3 power 4 is equal to 1 mod 5. 3 power 4 is equivalent to 1 mod 5. Let's take a completely different set of numbers. Let's take p is equal to 7. And let's take a is equal to 4, right? Now, here also, I will take powers of 4 and I will see a pattern here again. So if I take 4 power 1, 4 power 2, 4 power 3, 4 power 4, 4 power 5, 4 power 6, right? This is 4, this is 16, this is 64, then 256, then 8024, and times 4 is 4096, right? And times 7 also you can do. So 4 times this will be 16,384. Right. Now let's look at all of these numbers modulo 7. We are looking at a power n mod p, where n is a power that is increasing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And p is a prime number. The only condition being a and p, GCD is 1. Right? So in this case also, if you notice, let's write the modulus answers. This is 4 mod 7 here will be what?
2.
Mod 7 here will be 1.
1.
Mod 7 here will be what? 210 and 46, right? So 4. Then mod 7 here will be 32, 44, so 2. So you can see that pattern, right? 4, 2, 1, 4, 2, 1. This will also be 1, right? because 5, 5, 9, 56, 36, 35, so 1, right? I'm dividing by 7 and checking the remainder, right? So now we notice that 4 power 6 is also equivalent to 1 mod p. And earlier we had seen that 3 power 4 was also equivalent to 1 mod 5. Mod p here, p should have, I should have written it as 7. So this is 7. 1 mod 7. And here it was 1 mod 5. Right? So you will be able to see this pattern a lot. So any number, as long as the number does not divide p, a does not divide p, you will have a power n or a power p minus 1 will become equal to 1 mod p. As long as a is not congruent to 0 mod p. So basically a is not divisible by p. Okay. Because in that case, GCD of that will become what? Will become p, right? So you have to have this co-prime to each other type of situation. And as long as that is ensured, a power p minus 1 will be 1 mod p, where p is a prime number, p minus 1 is 1 less than that, right? So our claim for Fermat's little theorem is that if p is a prime, and a is not equal to 0 mod p, then a power p minus 1 is congruent to 1 mod p. So it leaves a remainder 1 when divided by p. And how do we want to prove this? So let's try to prove it by using this statement. So let's take these numbers a, 2a, 3a, 4a, and so on till p minus 1 into a. Okay. So let's think of these. How many numbers are here, first of all? How many numbers in this list?
P minus 1.
There are p minus 1 numbers, right? Let's look at all of these numbers mod p, right? Now, if you notice, these will give the same mods 1, 2, 3, p minus 1 mod p. So what I'm saying is that this list is going to be the same list as this. If you think of this list as mod p, right? Whatever value will be there will be these values only, because we have assumed that a is not divisible by p. You have assumed that a is not divisible by p, right? So whenever you divide this by p, right? Actually, a does not divide p, no? So technically it is going to be the same as 1 dividing p, right? One, it is going to give a remainder of 1, right? 1 into a. So think of numbers here. So I'll put some numbers on it and let's discuss them. A is equal to 3, for example. A is equal to 3, p is equal to 11. P is equal to 11, okay? Now, what are the possible remainders when you divide divide any number by 11? The possible remainders could be 1, 2, 3 till 10, right? These are the possible remainders. Correct. When you divide any number by 11, these are the possible remainders. Otherwise, the number will be divisible. Then the remainder will be 0. So in our case, let's consider the numbers 3 into 1, 3 into 1, 3 into 2, and so on till p minus 1. So 10 into 3, right? So the next number would have been 3 into 3. The next number would have been 4 into 3, and so on till 10 into 3, right? Now, just look at what the remainders will be when you think of all of these numbers modulo 11. So what is the modulo 11 of this? 3 modulo 11 is just 3, right?
Yeah.
For 6, it's just 6. For 9, it is just 9. For 12, what is it? It is 1, right? 5 into 3, 15, it will be 4. Then 18, it will be 7. Then 21, it will be 10. 24, it will be 2. 27 will be 5. And 30 will be 9, right? Correct?
Yeah.
Wait, 30 will be what? 30 modulo 11. No, 8, 8. What am I saying? 30 will be 8, no?
22. Minus 3 can also be.
Yeah.
Correct. So now look at this list of numbers. Isn't it covering everything 1 to 10? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, right?
Yeah.
So basically what we are saying is that this list and this list are identical, only the order is changed, right? Only the order is changed. This was arranged in a ascending order and this can be anywhere. But it will be the same numbers, right? Here we took an arbitrary number 3 and arbitrary prime p. All you have to do is take p minus 1 such numbers, multiply each of them by a. What we are saying is a, 2a, 3a, 4a, upon taking mod p, will come and become 1, 2, 3 till p minus 1 mod p, right?
Yeah.
Correct. This will be true as long as a does not divide p. So what we are saying is later we will study something called a residue class. So when we are talking about this 1, 2, 3 till p minus 1, that forms a complete residue class. Basically, all possible remainders are covered here, right? And this is also an equivalent residue class. This forms also an equivalent residue class, but I don't want to think of too many terminologies here. What I want to focus on is what is going on really. So I am taking these numbers and I am able to see that when I divide by a prime number, the remainders are the same as the remainders from this list, right? And the number of numbers in this list are also matching, right? This is also P minus one numbers. This is also P minus one numbers, right? Correct?
Yeah.
So, cool. So all of these numbers are definitely identical to some of each other. Like they are matching with each other, right? So if I multiply all of them, the product of these will be the same as the product of this on modulo P, right? What I'm saying is if two numbers were the same modulo with each other, right, with respect to a prime number P, right, then if you multiply those two numbers and then multiply the other two numbers, then they will still remain the same congruent modulo P, right?
Yeah.
So for example, take two examples, right? Take a few examples from here. So here I have 1 and 2, right? And which one was 1 for us? Which one was 1? 4 into 3 was 1, right? And which one was 2 for us? 2 for us was... which one was 2?
8 into 3, I guess.
8 into 3. 24 was 2, right? Correct. This was 12 and that one was 24, right? And so I'm saying 12 into 24 will be the same mod P as 1 into 2. It has to be 2 mod P. That is what I'm saying. If I take 1 into 2 here, the modulus will remain 2, right? And yeah. 12 into 24 is going to be let's do the calculation quickly. It is 288, right? 240 plus 48, yeah. 288. And what is it? 286 is divisible by 11, if you notice, right?
Yeah.
So it is still 2 mod P, no? Correct?
Yeah.
So what I'm saying now is that take this set of numbers, A, 2A, 3A, till P minus 1 into A, and take the set of possible remainders when you get till p minus 1, right? For a prime p, for a prime p, and for a is not equal to 0 mod p. A is not divisible by p. In that case, take these numbers, and take mod p. We know that that top list and the bottom list are the same, only the order might be different, right? Modulo p. So, I'm going to say that A into 2A into 3A into P minus 1A will be congruent to 1 into 3 into 1 into 2 into 3 till P minus 1 modulo P. That is my statement, right? Because they are the same numbers, no? The number of numbers is also same. It's the same two sets, right?
Yeah.
So here the number of numbers was p minus 1. So this can be written as a power p minus 1, and p minus 1 factorial is congruent to p minus 1 factorial mod p, right?
Yeah.
Now, great. Now we have a congruence like this. AC is congruent to BC mod p, right? Now, here from this congruence, you can divide and cancel the C as long as C does not divide P. As long as C does not divide P, you can cancel off the C from both sides. Otherwise, you cannot do it. Okay. If C does not divide P, then you can write it as A is congruent to B mod P from here. You should go back and try to prove that. Like if C divides P, then this might not always be true. But if C does not divide P, you can cancel off factors from both sides of a congruence. Okay. So this is a property that you should yourself be able to prove. You understand what I'm saying, right?
Problem statement. Yeah.
Right. So here you can easily notice that P minus 1 factorial will not divide P, because P minus 1, P is a prime number, right? P minus 1 factorial has all the numbers other than P from 1 to P minus 1, right? So that does not have any common factor with P, right? So we know that P minus 1 factorial does not divide P. Therefore, we can cancel off this, right? And we get Fermat's little theorem, 1 mod P, right?
Yeah.
Basically, I'm saying that this is relatively prime to this. You have to have C and P must be relatively prime to each other. The GCD of them should be 1. Then you can cancel off. So once you canceled off, you get Fermat's little theorem. Now, it is very important to be very careful about this theorem. So there are some points here that you need to be aware of, because the converse of the theorem is not true. Okay. So what I'm saying is, if P is not prime, first of all. If P is not prime, FLT does not work. So, for example, you can easily see that 5 power 5 is not congruent to 1 mod 6. This is not correct. It's actually going to be 5 power 5 is equal to 5 mod 6. You can check that yourself, or you can check 2 power 8. And find out mod 9, right? Here we are taking numbers which are not prime, right? What is this, right? So 2 power 8 is very easy to calculate. It's 256. 256 is equal to, what will be it be mod 9? It will be 4 mod 9.
Yeah.
Right? It is not 1 mod 9. So the theorem, our theorem looks like this. A power p minus 1 is equal to 1 mod p, where p is a prime. And A does not divide P, right? So here you have a prime and here you have power of P minus 1 here. So that part of it was correct in both the cases, right? 8 here and 9 here, right? But because the P itself was not prime, it doesn't work, right? Then the second thing is that the converse of that is not true, okay? Converse of Fermat's theorem is not correct. So that means what? What I'm saying is, if you have a power p minus 1 is equal to 1 mod p, right? Correct. If this congruence is true, it does not imply that p is a prime. Okay. It does not imply that P is a prime. So there was a question in the assignment previously, which was testing this idea only. So I think question number 10, part C. Question number 10, part C in problem set 3 was telling you that 2 power 52, 632 is equal to 1 mod 52, 633. Okay. And then he was asking you that, if this congruence is true, then can you say that this number is a prime number? Okay. Now, all the conditions of Fermat's little theorem seem to be satisfied here. like, first of all, this does not divide this, right? This is 2 and this is odd, right? Correct. And the powers are also in the correct way. This is n minus 1, this is n, right? Or this is p minus 1, right?
Yeah.
And the congruence is also true. Congruence is correct. This is a true statement. But Fermat's little theorem does not work in converse manner. So if you have the end point, this is true, then that doesn't mean that P is prime. If P was prime and 2 did not divide this, then we know that this is going to be 1 mod 5, 2, 6, 3, 3, right? But the reverse is not necessarily true, because now you can easily see that 5, 2, 6, 3, 3, 6, 3, 3 is divisible by 7. So 7, if you divide it by 7, you get 7 sevens are 49 and 3, 5, 1, 3. So 7, 5, 1, 3 is 1 and 9. 7, 5, 1, 9 into 7, right? Correct.
Yeah.
And there are probably other factors also for this. But already it is no longer a prime. So this was a question, finding out whether 52,633 is a prime or not. Just because this relation is true doesn't mean P is a prime. So you have to be quite careful here. This theorem works only in certain cases. Okay. So let's look at question number 10, part B also. So 10 part B says that 129 to the power 64,026 is congruent to 15,179 mod 64,027. Okay, he's saying that this is true. And then the question is asking, is 64,027 a prime or not, right? Something like this is the question. Let me just check once. It is asking 64,027 whether it is prime or not, right?
Correct.
So, okay. So right now let's think about this. So for Fermat's little theorem, this part is matching, right? Correct.
Yeah.
But what we have is, first of all, this is not equal to 1 here, right?
Yeah.
Correct. So for Fermat's little theorem, if you have something like this, a n minus 1 is not equal to 1 mod n, right? Correct. This is the situation here, no, right now. It is equal to some 15,179 is the remainder, right?
Yeah.
Not 1. So this can imply multiple things, okay? This can be because either n is composite, right? Because it was not a prime, that's why this happened, right? Correct. That could be one reason, right? Because we have seen situations like this before. We have seen 2 power 4, 2 power 8 is equal to 4 mod 9, right? We just now earlier saw this, no?
Yeah.
So whenever it is not 1 and everything else seems to be working, then you can sort of think that maybe the number itself was not prime, right? One second, just hold on for a moment. Yeah, so that could be a possibility. The other possibility is that the GCD of A and N is greater than 1. That was the second condition that we also had in Fermat's little theorem, right?
Yeah.
That these two numbers were not having any common factors, right? That they should be co-prime to each other. So now in this case, the reason that this is happening is because GCD of 64,027 and 129, if you take, right, they will have a common factor. The GCD is not equal to 1 here. For example, this is clearly divisible by 43 and 3, right? There are two prime numbers in its thing, right? So we can say that this is not divisible by 3. Then let's check whether it is divisible by 43, right? So you can clearly see that 21 will be 4 times 160, 172, 28, and 10, 38. Okay, wait. I'm doing it in my head, but I think it will be 14 only. Yeah. 382 will be going with 8. 344. So 36, 38, 387. 387 will go with 9.
Yeah.
Right? Correct. So you are clearly seeing that this is divisible by 43, right? So the common factor is GCD will be 43 and not 1. So it is obviously here, because GCD is 43, then N itself becomes composite, right? N is composite now. Correct. So basically you have to think of these things. So there are two preconditions for Fermat's little theorem to work, right? The preconditions are A and N should have GCD 1. And the other thing is that N should be a prime number, right? And also remember that the converse of the theorem is not true. Okay. So that is about the little theorem. Then what we go to is, can you think about it and tell me the question is whether there is some power x depending on the number m such that a power x is equal to 1 mod m. So what we are now trying to do is generalize what we got from Fermat's little theorem. Here this m is not necessarily a prime. What we want to say is that for non-prime numbers, can we figure out some pattern? Okay. Is there some power x for which a power x will be 1 mod m, right? Correct. So that is a slightly more advanced question. And the process of solving that question will introduce certain other ideas also. Okay, so what we will look at is, when can this happen? When can this happen? When we can say that a power x, right, is equal to 1 plus my, right, where y is an integer.
Correct? Yeah.
This congruence means this only, a power x is equal to 1 plus my. Okay. So therefore, what we can say is a power x minus my is equal to 1, right?
Yeah.
Correct. Now think about it. One precondition we can very quickly get, which will help us decide whether this can happen or not. So one condition is GCD of A and M should be equal to 1, must be satisfied. Because if it is not satisfied, if GCD of A and M, or A and M are not co-prime, right, then the left-hand side of this inequality, left-hand side, is divisible by the GCD, right?
Yeah.
By GCD, because GCD will divide both A and M, right? So it will be divisible by the GCD, right? But right-hand side is 1, right? So that gives an absurd conclusion that right-hand side, there is a GCD which is dividing 1, right?
Yeah.
Correct? So what we must have for this inequality to be true, we must have both A and M to be co-prime, right? So that is another condition that sounds very similar to the Fermat little theorem condition, right? Correct. So basically, yeah, I'm writing the statement here that if some power of A is congruent is congruent to 1 modulo m, 1 modulo m, then we must have, GCD of A and M is equal to 1, right? That is the conclusion that so far we have gotten, right?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So GCD of A and M must be 1. Okay, fine. So now we are still nowhere close to solving this. We still have to think about what X has to be for this to be true. We are talking about M not being prime, not a prime. So now that we have this, and we have the second condition that GCD A and M should be equal to 1. So then we can restrict, we can only talk about numbers A such that, about A such that it is coprime to M. No, it is coprime to M, right? Correct?
Yeah.
All the numbers that are relatively prime to M, we should only talk about those numbers then, right? Right? Because if this is not relatively prime, then this is impossible then, right? Makes sense.
Then M can be prime as well, right?
No. M is a prime when it is Fermat's little theorem, right? Then you don't have to worry about it.
Okay.
Then we know that the answer is P minus 1, right?
Yeah, M minus 1.
P minus 1, whatever is that prime.
Yeah.
So we are not talking about Fermat's little theorem. We are talking about M being composite. And if M is composite, then the A has to be coprime to it, right?
Yeah.
And if A has to be coprime, you can take it from this set. 1 is less than equal to A is less than equal to M. And GCD of A and M is equal to 1, right? Set of numbers which are smaller than M and coprime to M, right? So let's write our M in one side here, and let's write all the A possibilities, A possible values here, possible values. So if M is 1, A can only be 1, right? Right? 1 is coprime to 1. 1 is a special case. If M is 2, what can A be? A can be 1 only, right? It cannot be 2, right? Because 2 and 2 have a common factor of 2, right? You understand, what am I listing out? I'm listing out possible values of A, right? Possible values of A are numbers which are, I'm going to talk about smaller than M numbers, and I'm going to talk about only the coprime numbers, right? Then for 3, which numbers are smaller than 1 and smaller than 3 and coprime? It will be 1, 2, right?
Yeah.
For 4, it will be 1, 2, 3. No, not 2, obviously. 1 and 3. Right?
Yeah.
For 5, it will be 1, 2, 3, 4. Right? So basically, I'm going to get a set of numbers here which are basically coprime to M. Right? So now this is a quite an important concept. Okay? The set of numbers, smaller than M, set of numbers between 1 and M, that are coprime to M, is known as phi of M, called phi of M, and phi is Euler's phi function, Okay, it is the number of such numbers. So here, phi of 1, I will say, is 1. Phi of 2 is 1. Phi of 3 is 2. Phi of 4 is 2. And phi of 5 is 4, right? And so on. I can keep constructing the phi values, right?
Yeah.
This is the Euler's phi function. It is very important in number theory. What is the meaning of phi function? Phi of something is the set of numbers between 1 to that number such that they are coprime to M. And you have to count how many such numbers are there. That is phi of M, right? Now notice why I am introducing it in this way. The reason I'm introducing in this way is you can see a clear connection and a clear path between Fermat's Little Theorem to this point, right? So Fermat's Little Theorem was talking about a power p minus 1 is equal to 1 mod p, right? And yeah. After that, the next step, next question for anyone could be, is this true? Is this true for even composite numbers? Can it happen for a power x is equal to 1 mod some composite number m? That is the next step, right? So if we start thinking about composite numbers, we looked at this congruence, and this congruence is true only if GCD of a and m is equal to 1, right? This congruence can work only if GCD of a and m is equal to 1. So now we started listing out all the possible values of a for which this can happen. So what this means is that you will never get 2 power something is equal to 1 mod 4, right? This cannot happen, right? Because 2 and 4 don't have common GCD 1, no? Yeah. 2 and 4 have common factors, right? Which is a 2, right? So 2 does not belong to the set of common, set of the co-prime numbers smaller than m. Smaller than 4, right? So the only way it can happen for 4, the only time this can happen is if it is a 3 power something. 3 power something can give 1 modulo 4. Or 1 power something is obviously going to give 1 modulo 4, right? Yeah. Are you understanding what I'm saying? And are you seeing the connection from how do you got from Fermat's Little Theorem to the phi function, right? You are getting to this phi function because now we are thinking about, look at each composite number, find out the numbers which are co-prime to it and less than it, right?
Yeah.
Now, since now we are almost there, now what we'll do is we'll list out all those numbers, okay? We'll list out all those numbers. So let's do it by an example first, okay? So an example would be, I am going to try to find a power of 7, which is congruent to 1 modulo 10, This is what I'm going to try to find now, okay? Because is it possible at least? Is it possible the 10 power x is equal to 1 mod
10? Yeah.
Why is it possible?
GCD of 7 and 10 is 1.
GCD of 7 and 10 is 1. So for 10 modulo, you can get 1 as a remainder for which of the following numbers? So you can get it for the phi of 10, all the numbers that are in phi of 10, right? The set of phi of 10 numbers. So what are the numbers? 1, 3, 5, no, not 5, 1, 3, 7, and 9, right? Correct? I think so. 1, 3, 7, 9 are the numbers that are co-prime with 10.
Number of elements, right?
What? Number of? Phi of 10 is 4.
Yeah.
But the set of such numbers is 1, 3, 7, 9, right?
Yeah.
So the only powers which will give 1 modulo 10 will be 1, 3, 7, and 9. These powers only can give 1 modulo 10, right? Any other powers will never give 1 remainder.
7 raised to power 1 is not 1 mod 10, right?
I'm not saying every power of 3 will give 1 mod 10. I'm saying at least this can happen for this number.
Yeah.
Do you understand the difference? It will happen
for 4, right? Like 5 of 10 is 4.
Find a power of 4 which will give 1 remainder with 10. Can you find any number?
Possible, right? Because 4 and 10 and have GCD 2.
So that is what I'm saying. No, only powers of 3 can give a 1 remainder, or 7 can give a 1 remainder, or 9 can give a 1 remainder.
Yeah,
but that doesn't mean all powers of 3 will give 1 remainder, no?
Yeah.
You understand? What you're saying is not reasonable, right?
Yeah.
Only some few powers, otherwise there's no point only, no? Why are we doing this question? there will be some powers of x that will give one remainder. My job is to try to find that, right?
Yeah.
Not all powers will give, obviously. So if I have to find that, right? If I have to find that particular power of 7 that gives one remainder. So now let's look at this set of numbers, right? Let's look at this set of numbers, 1, 3, 7, 9. These were the set of co-prime numbers to 10, right? Modulo 10. And I need a power of 7. So what I will do is I'll construct numbers like this, 7 into 1, 7 into 3, 7 into 7, and 7 into 9. I will construct these numbers and take modulo 10 there. Take modulo 10 there, okay? So think of this number. This number is 7 modulo 10. I'm just writing the modulos in the denominator. This is 1 modulo 10. This is 9 modulo 10. And this is 3 modulo 10.
Yeah.
Now, can you see that same thing has happened? This sequence of numbers and this sequence of numbers are just a rearrangement, right?
Yeah.
Correct. So 1, 3, 7, 9 were the four numbers less than 10, which were co-prime to 10. Now, on multiplying them by 7, I am still getting four numbers which are co-prime to 10. I mean, which are, say, leaving the same remainders, right? Correct?
Yeah.
It's just that the order has been changed. Now, using the same trick that we used for proving Fermat's little theorem, I can multiply out these, right? And I will say that they will still remain congruent to each other, right? Because the list of numbers are themselves congruent to one of them, right? This was matched with this, this was matched with this, this was matched with this, and this was matched with this, right? So when you do a product and do modulo, it will still remain same congruency, right? So what we have now is 1, 3, 7, 9 modulo 10 is congruent to 7 power 4, 1, 3, 7, 9 modulo 10, no? Correct?
Yeah.
Correct? And notice that 1, 3, 7, 9, that does not divide 10, right? 1, 3, 7, 9 cannot divide 10, right? Or 10 cannot divide 1, 3, 7, 9. The GCD of these two are 1, right?
Yeah.
So you can cancel that from both sides of the congruence, right? Right?
Yeah.
So therefore, now I get that 7 power 4 is equal to 1 mod 10.
Yeah.
Correct. 7 power 4 is equal to 1 mod 10 we are getting. So we have found the x, right? We have found the x is equal to 4 here, right? Check the calculations. 343 into 7 is 2401. 7 power 4 is 2401, and that is 1 mod 10, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So this gives us a hint of what will be called as Euler's formula. An Euler's formula says that if GCD of A and M is equal to 1, right? Then A to the power 5 of M, right, will be congruent to 1 mod m. Now m here, m can be composite here. Okay, m can be composite here. We have basically solved this problem, right? Just now we solved this problem. Mod 10, right? We solved it for 10 and a was 7, right? And we got answer as 4, right? And notice that in that earlier thing, phi of 10 was coming as 4, no? Because 1, 3, 7, 9 were the four numbers, right? Correct. When we saw just now, this was happening, no?
Yes.
So that suggests this formula. That suggests this formula. So how to prove this? We have already worked out one case. So the proof is going to be easy for us. So let's try to prove it like this. So let's say let 1 is less than equal to b1 is less than b2 less than b3 till b of phi of m less than M, B the, see these B1, B2, B3, till B of phi of M, phi of M will be some value. B the phi of M numbers between 1 and M relatively prime to M. Relatively prime to M. So what are we saying here? We are saying that obviously for each M, so for example, if M is equal to 6, how many numbers are there which are relatively prime to 6? There will be phi of M will be the value of cardinality of that set. The number of numbers themselves are 1, 5, or 4, or no, not 4, 1, 5, that's it, right?
Yeah.
Correct. So phi of M in this case will be 2, right? Correct. So what this statement is saying is, let's make this as B1 and let's make it as B2. Because B phi of M, B2, right? Let's call it B1 and B2, right? He's just asking us to list down those numbers which are relatively prime to M and call them B1, B2, B3 till Bn, right? B phi of M. Correct. For 10, M is equal to 10. I would have said the set is 1, 3, 7, 9. So this would be called my B1, this would be called B2, B3, and this would be B4, right? Phi of M is 4 here.
Yeah.
Correct. So these are the numbers which are relatively prime. Now, what you do is, we can say that if GCD of A and M is equal to 1, only then this problem makes sense. If GCD of A and M is not equal to 1, this can never happen, right? This can never happen if GCD of A and M is not 1, right? So
yeah,
that means that A and M are relatively prime to each other. Therefore, the numbers B1A, B2A, and so on till B phi of M into A, right? These numbers are the same as the numbers B1, B2, B phi of M, no? Congruent modulo M, right? Modulo M, if you think about these numbers, and if you think about these numbers, they will be the same set, only the order will be changed, right? Because A is not dividing M. A and M are co-prime, right?
Yeah.
Multiplying by A doesn't add any factors which will affect M, right? Dividing by M, right? So the only thing that can happen is a rearrangement can happen. Do you understand?
Yeah.
So this and this are the same set. Then the product, now we'll repeat the same proof. Product of this will remain congruent to each other, right? So product of this will be B1, B2 till B phi of M and A power phi of M, because there are such phi of M, such numbers, right?
Yeah.
A power phi of M is congruent to B1, B2 till B phi of M mod M. And because we know that B1, B2, B phi of M and M, they don't have any common factors. So you can cancel off this.
Yeah.
You prove A power phi of M is equal to 1 mod M. So basically the proof for both Euler's formula and Fermat's little theorem are exactly the same. There is no difficulty in the proof.
It's similar case.
It's just a specific case. So Euler's formula is more general. Fermat's little theorem is a specific case. So if you compare the two, if you compare the two and this one, that suggests something, that phi of any prime number will be equal to p minus 1.
Yeah.
If m is a prime, then this phi of m must become this, right? And that can be easily proven. Take a prime number 5, for example, right? What are the numbers from 1 to 5 which are co-prime with this? 1, 2, 3, 4, right?
Yeah.
So phi of 5 is 4. Similarly, phi of 7 will be 1, 2, 6, all the numbers, right? 4, 5, 6. So 5 of 7 will be 6. Correct? Make sense?
Yeah.
So basically, we have this result that phi of a prime number is equal to p minus 1, right? This is the first result that you have about the phi function, right? Now, the second point to think about here is that this Euler's formula is going to be useful for us, but it is only going to be useful if we are able to get the value of phi of m, no? For many different numbers, right? If you can't figure out what is phi of m, then anyway, this is useless, no? You can't do much with it then, right?
Yeah.
And I don't want to calculate phi of m by actually trying to list out all the numbers from 1 to m and finding out which ones are coprime, right? Calculate phi of m, we must have some nice way to do this calculation. Otherwise, it's useless, this Euler's formula, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So the only thing that we so far know is that phi of a prime number is p minus 1, right? So we want to develop some new ways to find phi for other numbers also, okay? Then only we'll be able to use Euler's theorem effectively to make our calculations easier in the future, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's look at some easy cases. So for example, one case is, let's calculate the phi of a power of a prime, right? Phi for a power of a prime. So let's calculate phi of basically, let's say 81. So this is equal to phi of 3 power 4, right? Correct?
Yeah.
So think about it. What is the phi of 81, okay? So when is a number a not relatively prime to p power k, not relatively prime to p power k, right? We have to remove those numbers, no?
Yeah, factors.
We have to only count the factors which are, we have to only count the numbers which are relatively prime, right? Correct. In the calculation of phi of p power k, we have to count only numbers which are relatively prime to p power k. So we have to remove all the numbers which are not relatively prime to p power k, right? So if you list down all the numbers, 1, 2, 3 till you have p power k. So total number of numbers are how many? P power k, right? This is the maximum. This is the total number of numbers from 1 to p power k, right? And then we have to subtract the numbers which have common factors, right?
Yeah.
Correct. So numbers here, some numbers, this set is such that a is such that 1 is less than a is less than equal to p power k. And P divides A, right?
Yeah.
Must be divisible by P or something, right? Okay. So if you think about P power K, the only prime number in that P power K number is P, right? So all the numbers that have common factors will have P as a factor, no?
Yeah.
All the numbers that have common factors will have P as a factor. So how many numbers can you make with P as a factor? That's very easy. You start by listing out all the multiples of P, right?
Yeah.
All the multiples of P, if you start listing out, then eventually you will hit this number. P power K minus 1 into P will be equal to P power K, right?
Yeah.
Correct. So eventually you will hit this number. And here it is, power is... basically, you are starting from P and going to this place, right? So the second last number will be P power K minus 1 minus 1 into P, right? Or basically, this number is P power K minus P power minus P, right? This number is this, p power k minus p, right? Correct.
Yeah.
So obviously we don't have to count the last number, right? Because last number will not be coprime to p power k. Their GCD will be p power k itself, right? So we have to count all the numbers from here to here, no? That are not relatively prime, right?
Yeah.
You cannot take the last number in that set. Do you understand? If you take the last number, no, then they have a p power k as a GCD, right?
Yeah.
So the set of numbers that we have to remove are these p, 2p, 3p till 1p less than p power k, right?
Yeah.
Correct. So how many numbers are here? How many numbers are here? These are 1, 2 till p power k minus 1 minus 1, right? So there will be p power k minus 1 numbers here. If you think about it, there are p power k minus 1 numbers here, because you start with 0, p power 0 minus 1, no, p, 2p, 3p, how many are there? Just take some example to figure it out. So let's put 3, right? P is a prime number, 3, and power is 4, right? This example only, right? So what are the numbers here? 3, 2 into 3, 3 into 3, right? Till this is 3 power 3 minus 1, right? So 26, right?
Yeah.
3 power 3 minus 1, 26 into 3, right? So that is becoming actually bigger, no? No, it is fine. 26 into 3 is 78, right?
Yeah, 78.
So that is fine, right? So the number of numbers that are coming here are 23 per 27, no? Because you have 1 into 3, 1 till 26 you are going. Is it 27 or is it 26?
26.
Correct. It is seeming like it is 26, right? It should be p power k minus 1, dude. Okay. The subtraction should come out to be p power k minus p power k minus 1. Now, let's think about why it is not working out very nicely. What is the point here? Till here, the numbers were power k minus 1 into p. Should be p power k minus 1. Can anyone figure it out? I don't know why I'm not getting it right. 1, 2, 3. Okay, so we have to just count all the numbers from 1, 2, 3 till p power k minus 1 minus 1, right? Actually, I think we have to count till here. Okay, we were counting all the divisible numbers. No, what am I doing? We have to count this number. We have to remove it later, right?
Yeah.
Because anyway, later we are subtracting, no?
Yeah, because p raised to power k already includes this one.
So right now we are saying we have to count all the numbers which are divisible by p. So we have to go one step further to this number also.
Yeah.
Right? So that becomes p power k minus 1, right? 27, right? Till 81 we have to go. And all of those numbers we'll remove, right? Eventually. So this doesn't come later, final answer, right? So, so now it is clear that the number of such numbers which are divisible are p power k minus 1. Basically, there are p power k minus 1 multiples of p from 1 to p power k, right? Which seems fairly obvious, no? Because see, the power is 1 here, 2 here, till p power k means, right?
Yeah.
So those numbers we are going to exclude. Any number other than that will basically not be divisible by p, right? Any number other than that will not be divisible by p.
Yeah.
And if it is not divisible by p, therefore it cannot be divisible by p power k, right? Cannot have any common factor, right?
Yeah.
So we have found that phi of p power k will be equal to total number of numbers minus all the numbers divisible by p, which is this, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So that now gives us another tool. Now we can answer this question, right? Phi of 81, we can easily say, will be 3 power 4 minus 3 power 3, which will be 81 minus 27, so 54, right? Earlier, yeah, we didn't know how to say phi of 81, okay? When you knew, yeah, just because 81 is not a prime number, no? So you didn't know what to do, right?
Yeah.
So now two things you know. One is phi of p is equal to p minus 1. Second thing is phi of p power k is equal to p power k minus p power k minus 1, right?
Yeah.
Now, the next thing is, let's say you have a number phi of m, but m can be written as the powers p power j and q power k, where p and q are prime.
Yeah, composite.
Right. P and q are prime. And basically, this is any number, right?
Yeah.
Any number can be written as a product of primes, that is prime factorization, right?
Yeah.
So we are going to try to think about these numbers now, phi of such composite numbers, right? So the,
yeah,
process is actually not very difficult. So what it turns out that phi of p power j q power k is the same as phi of p power j into phi of q power k. Okay. So that becomes p power j minus p power j minus 1 and q power k minus q power k minus 1, right?
Yeah.
Because we know powers of a prime phi how to find, right?
Yeah.
Correct. So basically the idea is that if you have two numbers, phi, m, n, and m and n have no common factors. M and n are relatively prime to each other. M and n have no common factors, but it is a product of two numbers, m into n here. So that will be equal to phi of m and phi of n. Because look at this case here, p power j and q power k have no common factors, right?
Yeah.
So that is equal to phi of p power j into phi of q power k, right? So then individually, if you can find this and find this, then you are done, right? So this, if you have this theorem, you are basically going to be able to prove or find phi for any number, right?
Yeah.
Because you can repeatedly use it, no? For a prime factorization of, say, 2 into 3 in something, right? 2 square, let's do m is equal to 2 square, 3, 3, and 7 power 1, right? We can say, yeah, phi of m will be equal to phi of 2 square 3 3 into phi of 7 power 1, right?
Yeah.
And this part can be split as phi of 2 square, phi of 3 cube, and phi of 7 power, right?
Yeah.
So it becomes simply this one is 2 square minus 2 1, and this one is 3 cube minus 3 square, and this one is 7 power 1 minus 7 power 0, right?
Yeah.
So that becomes 4 minus 2 is 2. This becomes 27 minus 9 is 18, and this becomes 7 minus 1 is 6, right? So it is, answer will be 18 into 12, right?
Yeah.
216 will be the phi of this number. So now any composite number can therefore be done, right?
Yeah.
So there is a proof for this also, the proof for this, but right now I don't want to discuss the proof. I want to apply how to apply this result, right? we can discuss this proof at some stage. We'll probably do it also. Not very difficult. We just have to show that. Actually, I'll discuss it later. Right now, let's not worry about it. We'll do some questions of this. So what I want to do is apply this Euler's formula now and get some value. So first question that I have for you guys is find phi of 97. Find phi of 97 and then find phi of 8,800. Okay. Find out the values, try it out.
It will be 9,600.
Which one?
The phi of 97.
Phi of 97 will be 96, correct? Because it is a prime number?
Yeah.
Okay. This one? You are doing the calculations, no?
Yeah.
Okay. Prime factorization of it is 11 into 5 square into 2 power 5.
Yeah.
So 5 of that will be simply 5 of 2 power 5 will be 2 power 5 minus 2 power 4. And phi of 5 square will be 5 square minus 5 power 1. And this one will be 10. 11 is a prime. This will be 32 minus 16. So 16 into 25 minus 5. So 20 into 10. So
3200.
Right. The next question is, if m is greater than or equal to 3, explain why phi of m is always even.
Because it's a product of prime numbers, right? And phi of prime is always less than one, which and all prime numbers are mostly like all greater than are odd. That's why.
M is greater than 3. What are you saying?
All prime numbers are odd, like above 3, including 3.
This is P1 power E1, P2 power E2. And so on, PR power ER, right?
M. Yeah.
And let's say M is greater than or equal to 3, right?
Yeah.
So phi of M will come out to be basically P1 power E1, phi of this one, right? So that will be P1 power E1 minus P1 power E1 minus 1, right?
Yeah.
Multiplied by P2 power E2 minus P2 power E2 minus 1 and so on.
Okay? Yeah.
PR power ER minus PR power ER minus 1.
Yeah, so, now we take common then.
Take common what?
Yeah, like from P1 raised to E1, we can take then P1 minus 1 and then it will become
even. So you'll get P1, E1 minus 1 common and you get P1 minus 1, right?
Yeah.
And similarly, we can do for everyone. P2 minus 1 and so on.
Yeah.
Right? And PR minus 1.
Yeah.
And powers are here. That doesn't matter here because all the other primes are odd. P1 minus 1 will be even, right?
Yeah.
So as long as you don't have 2 here, right?
Yeah.
Like if you have 3, 5, 7, those primes, right? So there will be P1 minus 1, 2 will come definitely as a factor, right?
Yeah.
If there is any prime including 3, any prime higher than 3 in the factorization, right? then you are done, right? You will get an even number.
Yeah.
If all the numbers are like is only till 2, m is equal to 2, then obviously you'll not get. Right?
Yeah.
Then because you will get 2 power 2 minus 2 power 1 minus 2 power 0, right? For the number 2, right? So that will be 2 minus 1, 1, right? For m is equal to 2, you only have 1. Phi of m is 1 if m is 2.
Yeah.
As soon as you come to 3, you start getting even numbers.
Yeah.
Right? And any higher number will definitely have... what if it was m is equal to 8? It will be 2 power 3. So what will happen then? 2 power 3 minus 2 power 2.
It will still become a multiple of 2. Right?
It will still be a multiple of 2 because 2 is a factor, right?
Yeah.
So for all 2 powers, it will be a multiple of 2. And for all other odd powers, obviously it is a multiple, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Then what I want to look at is... Okay, so I want to prove a formula. So let's look at, suppose that P1, P2, and PR are distinct primes that divide M, right? Now, prove this formula for phi m. Phi m is equal to m times 1 minus 1 by p1, 1 minus 1 by p2, and so on, 1 minus 1 by pr. Prove this formula for phi m. Okay. And later, the second part of the question says that use the formula to compute phi is equal to phi of 10 power 6. Okay. First, we have to derive this formula. Okay.
Yeah.
So think about it. So just break up M as some number, yeah, K1, K2, some product of these primes. So M can be written as P1 power, let's say K1, P2 power K2, something like this, PR power KR.
Yeah.
Now, normal method of phi m will give us each of these ones will become P1 power K1 minus P1 power K1 minus 1, right? And this one, yeah, will become P2 power K2 minus P2 power K2 minus 1 and so on. And last one is PR power KR minus PR power KR minus 1, right? Okay, great. So immediately you can say that I can take P1, K1 common, right?
Yeah.
And it will become 1 minus 1 by P1, right? And P2, K2. This is obvious. Now it is over.
Yeah, yeah.
So we have proved it because we can take P1, K1, P2, K2 and so on and multiply and write it as M, right? And you get this.
Yeah.
So that is a nice looking formula. The reason this formula is better than the earlier one is because earlier one involved us doing more calculations than this, because this one, yeah, I'll directly use 10 power 6. And what are the factors? 2 and 5, right?
Yeah.
1 minus 1 by 2, 1 minus 1 by 5, right?
Yeah.
That's all. We just need to know the prime factors. We don't need to do the power calculation so much, right? Slightly better. So 10 power 6, and this is half, and this is 4 by 5, right? So this is 10, so 10 power 5 into 4. 4 into 10 power 5 will be the answer, right?
Yeah.
Correct. Okay. 400,000. Correct. Fine. So more or less, this is the theory for the Euler's phi function. I didn't get time to solve the questions in the previous exercise. So we will have to have a doubts class for the questions in the previous exercise. Okay. So yeah. Assignment 3 questions. Any doubts that you have, we will discuss it probably on Monday or Tuesday evening. Monday or Tuesday evening?
Two as well, right?
Assignment two, there are three questions, right?
Yeah.
Assignment two, there are last two, three questions.
Yeah.
And I will send you assignment four by tomorrow latest. Assignment four will be for this week to next Friday. Okay. So yeah. Assignment four I'll share by tomorrow latest, and assignment two and assignment three. These are the ones that I will discuss in a doubts class on Monday or Tuesday. Otherwise, we'll continue from this point. Okay. The next things for us, the next chapters and the ideas that we have to cover are basically, we'll start looking at special types of prime numbers, Mersenne primes, perfect numbers, powers modulo m. So basically, now it's about some special types of problems that we'll handle by the tools that we have learned so far. So we'll be applying congruences, we'll be applying Euler's formula, Fermat's little theorem, and trying to deduce some more results from this point forward. Okay.
Yeah.
So some special problems. Theoretically, we are on the way to completing the part. There is some more theory that is left, but we'll go ahead and cover it in the next few weeks. Okay. That's all for now. I'll see you guys on Monday or Tuesday. I'll let you know. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.